I get it.
Same question. What were you dealing with, people managing alliances, as you went through the game?
So, I'm basically the neurotic New Yorker. I was going to be very emotional. I can't hide that. And I decided I was going to take that, you know, quote-unquote weakness and use it as a social strategy, as a strength. It's not that the emotions were fake and I was building these relationships. It's that I wasn't going to hide them.
Can I just interject? Your emotions in this game do play a role and you have to feel those emotions, but does that affect how you navigate your next move?
I can't control and turn them on and off so quickly, but when they come out, it was using them as a social strategy in my game.
Julie, so as somebody that was on the receiving end of one of many emotional breakdowns, you're saying that that was used as a strength in your game is like, come on, like,
well, I think we may not be giving you enough credit for how clever your game might have been. Just give me one big move that you think you did.
So, using my emotions as part of my strategy, the tribal council that Julia got voted out, I do feel like I swayed that vote.
Julie,
did you ever even think there was a possibility going to tribal that night that you would have been voted out? Like, no.
0.01, probably.
Let me explain.
Go ahead.
I was feeling rock bottom. Ron's paranoia was sky high. But I had a very specific idea of how I wanted that tribal council to go. I had already thrown out Julia's name that day.
But I don't feel like the vote would have switched if I hadn't said anything and War Dogs hadn't caught on right away.
What I meant was it was going to become a catalyst for some conversations that were going to start. All I needed to do was get the conversation going, and I jumped on it fast.
All right, so wait this straight. Your most clever move was to possibly throw out Julia's name and then hope a War Dog would come save the day?
No, it wasn't that I considered that you saved the day, but I knew I wanted to try and switch things up.
And then let Chris and Gavin answer the question for sure.
Yes, I think a big move that I made, you know, even though I don't feel great about it, was people like Aubrey and Joe, people that I knew were respected players, but that's where I had to separate my heart from the gameplay, so.
It was very clear. I felt like a piece of taxidermy, quite frankly, this season. But to be fair, Gavin was one of the only people to come up to me and even pretend that he was willing to work with me. I was willing
to work with you.
I will say, too, that the person I trusted of the three of you was Gavin.
So, Chris now?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, I know the original question to me was that I spent 28 days on the edge of extinction. And I just want to remind you guys that, like, Julie did not go to a tribal council until day 17 at the merge. So basically, we were on the same playing field, you know.
So we know you only played like 12 days in the actual game,
yeah,
but that's ample time to make a big move. Just big move.
Okay.
Great.
So getting back into the game, I knew that I had to get through one tribal with no immunity around my neck, no idols at play. But I got Lauren to promise me that if Devin's idol was real, that she was going to play her idol for me.
Are you claiming that as your move, to get Lauren to play her idol?
Yeah, I'm claiming that was a really big strategic move because we all knew Lauren had an idol. Thank you, Kelly.
Lauren,
how did he convince you to do that?
I know, right? It's really sad.
To answer your question, Ron, it's actually a sales technique. It's called a negative reverse. You have to be less okay than a prospect for them to feel like they need to save you.
No, he played me like a violin. Like, he was beautiful. Sad.
Clever.